وأشهد أن محمد عبده ورسوله أرسله الله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد صلاة وسلام دائمين متلازمين إلى يوم الدين أما بعد all praises to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala we seek his assistance, his guidance and forgiveness and we take refuge with him from the evil within our souls and from the consequence of our misdeeds. Whoever Allah gives guidance to, none can mislead. Whoever he misleads, none can guide. I bear witness that there's no one and nothing worthy of worship other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I also bear witness that Muhammad, the son of Abdullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is his slave and messenger. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant mercy and peace and to give his blessing to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, to also bless his family members, his companions, and all those who follow goodness and goodwill until the meeting and the reckoning with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a hadith, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, La yu'minu ahadukum hatta akuna ahabbi ilayhi min walidihi wa waladihi wa nasi ajma'in. That none of you truly believes until I am more beloved to him than his father, his son or child, and all of humanity. This, amongst many other hadith, are examples of those particular reminders that as a Muslim and as a believer, that there are stations to faith, there are different levels to faith. And that simply by being a Muslim does not automatically translate into an individual being considered to be perfect in terms of one's faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, faith is something that one is expected to grow into. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, he says that what he does for the believers is that يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ, that he brings them out of darknesses into the light. And that is to say that an individual, even after accepting the religion, can still, in many regards, be misguided. If we haven't done the work that is necessary in order to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And another example, another story, a companion came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and he said to him, Ya Rasulullah, matas-sa'a? O Messenger of Allah, when is the hour? When is the last day? And then he said to him, what have you prepared for it? And the man responded, I haven't prepared anything for it, not much prayer, not much charity, only that I love Allah and his messenger. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam responded to him saying, Anta ma'a man ahbabta, that you will be with those whom you love. And so this idea of love, and in particular the love of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, has a very special status amongst the Muslims, amongst the believers in Islam. And Islam, as we remember, is a religion, not only the name of this religion that we adhere to, but it is a reality that we are seeking to achieve or realize in our lives. It is something, it is an ideal that we're seeking to realize in our lives. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَمَنْ يُبْتَغِي غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ, that whoever seeks a religion other than Islam as a way of life, then it will not be accepted from him. And that person will be amongst the losers in the hereafter. That whoever does not seek Islam, and Islam itself, as you know, in its linguistic meaning, it means surrender, a submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why it is possible for us to say about the children of Israel, those who were following the Sharia of Musa alayhi salam, and then when they came to the time of Isa ibn Maryam alayhi salam, that they were not converts from Judaism into Christianity. Rather, they were people, they were Muslims, they were surrendering their wills to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because they were told by Moses that another prophet would come after them, and that would be Isa ibn Maryam. As Isa ibn Maryam told them that another prophet after them would be Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Islam is something that we are expected to strive for. It is an ideal for all the Muslims. And we know that we are on the these days are days where we commemorate the birth of our beloved Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as we commemorate his birth and this great event and the lives of humanity, that we know as well that there are many Muslims who every single year we argue about the permissibility of doing so. And those who consider it permissible to do so, that they would argue or might argue that it is because of our love for the Prophet ﷺ that we do so. But on the other hand, those who choose not to do so would also argue that it is because of our love for the Prophet ﷺ that we do not do so. Because they're different perspectives. The one particular perspective is that if they don't believe that the Prophet ﷺ authorized something for them to do, then they believe that that itself is tantamount to showing their love for the Prophet ﷺ. So if they believe that the Prophet didn't allow it, then they believe that this is what love necessitates. On the other hand, others have a different view, a different perspective on this issue. And I've mentioned this before in the past, that the thing that bothers me quite often about this issue is that Muslims continue to argue over it every single year, that we complain about the people who malign us for our particular positions. If you have a position, then you are your position. You don't need acceptance of another to vouch for what you do. If you believe that what you're doing is correct, then there's no need for you to complain about others who are saying that what you're doing is not correct. Otherwise, it seems that you're not confident about your view. At any rate, that the Prophet ﷺ, in another occasion, a man came to him, and he said to him, as in the other report, Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of Allah, verily I love you. Inni uhibbuk. And then the Prophet ﷺ, in this narration, said to him, Unzur ma taqul. Watch what you say. Watch what you say. And then the man, he repeated himself, he said, Ya Rasulullah, inni uhibbuk, inni uhibbuk, inni uhibbuk. Oh, Messenger of Allah, I love you, I love you, I love you, I swear to God, I love you. He said to him three times. And then the Prophet responded to him and said to him, فَأَعِدَّ لِلْفَقْرِ تِسْفَافًا. Then you are to prepare them, you should prepare a coat of mail for poverty. You should prepare a coat of mail for poverty. And this tishfav is what you would place over the horse. In war times, the chain mill that was placed over the horses is what the Prophet ﷺ, as a metaphor, he mentioned to this particular companion, said, you should prepare this for poverty, because poverty is something that comes fast to those people who love me, in this particular report. Which is a very amazing thing when you think about it. And that is to say that when we start to make claims of our love for the Prophet ﷺ, that we have to make sure that it is not a very empty claim, and it is not a superficial claim. That our love for the Prophet ﷺ is not simply just about us remembering how great a guy he was, or speaking about that wonderful ideal of a person. That the Prophet ﷺ, he also came with a mission. And so being an individual who claims or truly loves the Prophet ﷺ, we have to be an individual who believes in the mission of the Prophet ﷺ. And one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ, he brought was the Quran. He brought the Quran, and in the Quran, we say it is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, when you talk at times with certain Muslims, you can get the impression that Muslims would wish that certain things about the Quran were never even mentioned. I'll give you some examples. That the Quran mentions something about whipping people 100 lashes for fornication. The Quran talks about cutting off hands for theft. The Quran, it makes mention of things about taking concubines in war. Right? The Quran, even in one particular verse, it makes a mention of how an individual, a husband, who is actually is giving direction to a husband to try to correct the behavior of a miscreant wife, and actually says, "Wadribuhunna," and hit them.
Now, of course, these things should all be contextualized. But the point to highlight them is not to say that Muslims, that there is not an appropriate way to understand these things. But at times it seems that Muslims, we are afraid to even mention that these things exist. Or we wish that they didn't even exist. And so that even when sometimes Muslims bring them up, it's as if we want them to be quiet and shut up. Don't say that because the non-Muslims may hear it. You know, and they'll read this stuff and it discourages them from Islam. So no, they can open up any Quran, any book and read it on their own. Because we may not have the explanation doesn't mean that it's not true. But it's important for us to understand is that if we lack the trust, and we have lost trust in the interpreters of the verses, if we lost trust in the scholars, then we cannot lose trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That one of the major mistakes of Iblis, of Shaytan, when we read in the Quran and it says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that he cursed Satan because of his disobedience. And he did not curse Adam, even though Adam disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That fundamentally the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cursed Satan was because Satan not only disobeyed God, but Satan questioned God's wisdom. That what did he say? Why didn't you prostrate to Adam? I didn't prostrate him because I'm better than him. He created me from fire, created him from clay. Right? I can see that. So if there's anyone who's more worthy of being prostrated to than it's me, I can see that. Why can't you, oh God? And so questioning the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Muslims have to at least, when we start talking about this idea of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love of the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it's about loving what they love and hating what they hate. But most importantly, not questioning the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even if we don't understand what that wisdom may be. And so this is extremely important for Muslims going forward, because as we are trying to integrate into a society and seeking acceptance in this particular society, because at times when we ask the question of who is truly the exemplar, who is the standard of humanity, and then you ask the average Muslim, we'll say that it is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. That you have an excellent example in the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. That the average Muslim will tell you that he is the standard. But at other times you get the impression that the Muslims believe there's something, some other standard. That the standard is what we at times euphemistically refer to as the West. That the West is the standard. So even by prophets' actions have to be measured up and have to be judged on the basis of what those people in the West say about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's actions. And so we're conflicted. We're conflicted in many different ways. So either the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the standard for true humanity, or he is not. And if we believe that he is not, then we need to question the sincerity of our faith. So when we start arguing over and over and over every single year about who loved the Prophet the most, then I think that all of us have enough to reflect upon and enough to become the basis for judging our own sincerity, that we can leave off those type of argumentations. That if you want to celebrate, then go ahead and celebrate. But don't celebrate just simply by eating a nice meal and doing a nice, singing a bunch of nice songs. But this has to be about you reevaluating your faith, about you thinking about how much of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not in you. How much of him is not in you? Because he is the example, he is the ideal, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he help us to achieve that ideal. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'il muslimin wa muslimat. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salam ala khatma anbiya, wa sallam al-muslimin, nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.
إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم إنا نسرخ الجنة وما يقرب إليها من قول وعمل ونعوذ بك من النار وما يقرب إليها من قول وعمل اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا بها جنتك ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عادانا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخاف فينا ولا يرحمنا اللهم لا تدع لنا ذنبا إلا غفرت ولا هما إلا فرجت ولا دينا إلا قضيت ولا حاجة من حوائج الدنيا والآخرة إلا قضيتها يا أرحم الراحمين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وقنا عذاب النار وقنا عذاب النار وصلى اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه الأخيار وسلم تسليما كثيرا وسبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون والسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين وأقم الصلاة.